for your right of reply. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Sir, Mr. Speaker, sir, just to provide some clarification that was raised by Honourable Prasad, firstly, he said about the Act of God being, you know, applied universally across the Act. It's not a carte blanche approach. If you look, Mr. Speaker, sir, I refer the Honourable Prasad to Section 24 Amendment, and it says, in subsection 1, which is close to, in subsection 1, in the chapter after must inserting blah, 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 blah. Then if you turn the page, it says, under C, it says, in this section, subclause 2, in this section, Act of God includes a pandemic declared by the World Health Organization. So it's in relation to that section, not a carte blanche approach across the Act itself, number one. No, number two, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, sir, I'm sorry, I'm distracted. Mr. Speaker, sir, the again, as we've said, that this provides certainty. In some jurisdictions, acts of God have been dragged through the court system. It becomes very arduous for both the parties. At this point in time, as we've said, that COVID-19 has presented us, and the only certainty about COVID-19 is the uncertainty. So wherever we can, we need to provide certainty for ourselves, the different stakeholders, the employers, the employees. So by having this definition, we're actually telling both the parties, this is what will happen in respect of not being able to provide work under the contract that has been put in place. And an act of God, which the employer actually has to prove. If you read the Act, the particular section, the burden of proof is on the employer. Because should it be debated, should it be challenged, it's the burden of proof is on the employer to prove that it was an act of God. And the act of God in this case is the pandemic. They can't, for example, assuming their business is going well, and because he wakes up one morning and says, I'm going to fire all 50 of them now, because, you know, I don't like the faces or something, he can't do that, or she can't do that. He or she has to prove it is because of the pandemic, if he's going to use the pandemic argument. So that's the safeguard that's been provided in the particular section. Honourable Prasad has got two ideas that he's been clinging on to, notwithstanding the fact, the fragility of those arguments. Number one, he's saying that because of the decrease in the superannuation contribution by the employer, government is saving all this money, so he's got all this money lying around. As an economist, he should understand that revenue has depleted by over $1 billion. So it's not like revenue has decreased by $1 billion. Yet, Mr. Speaker, sir, if he looks at the 1920 budget and the 1920 COVID budget response, expenditure has only decreased by $300 million. Because we have maintained the services that's required by government to the members of the public. Infrastructure is still being carried out. Other operations of government is still being carried out. The statutory bodies that receive the grants still get the grants. There has been a reduction in expenditure of only $300 million, notwithstanding the fact that revenue has plummeted. No more tourists, finished. Revenue is gone from that area. Nightclubs, finished. The VET, STT, ECAL, gone. Garment industry, three-quarters gone. Whatever the case may be, so revenue has decreased. This is why that by only reducing expenditure by $300 million, your deficit's gone up by 9%. That's why. So, you know, the opposition members have been saying this, but they need to understand the maths of it. I saw, again, you know, the erstwhile Fiji Times, in today's front page, another former governor has got his maths wrong. Again, because he's missed the fact that revenue has decreased by $1 billion. Now, the other thing, Mr. Speaker, sir, that has been talked, Honourable Prasad talked about the Workers' Solidarity Fund. I mean, they've grabbed on to this idea and said, oh, what the Australians gave, put into their Workers' Solidarity Fund. The workers don't want some fund set up. The workers actually want money given to them on a regular basis. The COVID-19 budget, Mr. Speaker, sir, the budget estimate, as has been allocated, and he is absolutely right. As the weeks and months go ahead, things will be getting tougher if the economy does not bounce back. The bubble does not open, which is what we have said throughout. Even when we were accused previously of saying, oh, you're allowing people to take out the $1,000. We are saying we will be the ones that will be holding the can. Because we know that most people, firstly, even up front, did not have the $1,000. And in the second wave, less people have $1,000. As I mentioned, at least we are doing it in a progressive manner, sustainable manner, and in a deliberate manner, Mr. Speaker, sir. Not setting up some fun. You see, it's a budgetary allocation. Please read the budget book. Please read the budget book. And, Mr. Speaker, sir, let me highlight. Head 50, Mr. Speaker, sir, line 13. $40 million, Ministry of Health. Fiji Police Force, additional $700,000. RFMF, $150,000. Agriculture, additional $1 million. FCCC, $100,000. Unemployment benefit, tourism sector, $5.6 million. Unemployment benefit, lockdown areas, formal sector, $7 million. Unemployment benefit, lockdown areas, informal sector, $3 million. Unemployment benefit, general, $5 million. Assistance to SMEs, $5 million. Contingency funds, unemployment, $5 million. Contingency funds, general, $27.45 million. Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, sir. So the reality of the matter is, I mean, God willing, in 2-3 months' time, things may change. Who knows? But if it doesn't change, Mr. Speaker, sir, obviously the budget will make the fiscal space for government to continue these unemployment benefits. And as we have said, Mr. Speaker, sir, we're not going for this gimmickry thing, solidarity fund, etc. We will make sure people get money on a regular basis.
Yeah.
We have said at this point in time, $220 a fortnight for anybody in the formal sector. As announced the other day and also announced last week, Mr. Speaker, sir, we are currently now working out mechanisms as to how to assist those people who are still employed but at extremely reduced hours. You cannot, for example, expect a person to survive on one day's work. You cannot expect a person to necessarily survive on 2 days' work if they're the sole breadwinner. But on the other hand, Mr. Speaker, sir, there are some other people who have reduced hours of only 1 day short now. They're working 4 days. So should the person who's working 4 days be paid the same amount of unemployment benefit as the person who's working only 1 day? Obviously not. So we need to work out the mechanism. These things aren't necessarily easy. But once we get the policy right, it will be sustainable. It will be fair. It will be accountable. And all those people receiving the benefits will say, yes, okay, we've been treated fairly and justly. That's what we want. And believe you me, Mr. Speaker, sir, after the announcement of this, we've had a lot of positive reports, a lot of positive feedback from people saying thank you for this. Because some people also complain, we don't like lump sum payments because somebody may go off and buy a TV set. We were told stories that people are receiving funds from FNPF in Ellery Street and going straight to some of the duty-free stores. Now, obviously, we don't want that because at the end of the day, if they spend their money in a TV or a stereo, they'll depend on government for the money to buy food. So we now depositing $220 a fortnight into their bank accounts. This is why we're working with FNPF. So, Mr. Speaker, sir, I think there's a lot of talk about it, and regarding this, and I just wanted to clear that up, Mr. Speaker, sir. And I again, Honourable Tikon Duandua said, it looks like we're always getting the workers to give in their rights. That's not true. These two leaves, the days of which we are reducing, was introduced by government. There was no specific submission made on this. We did it unilaterally. All we're saying is only for a specific period of time. The reality of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, sir, if the garment factory owner says, look, this is all too difficult, and I've got all these people taking, family care leave and paternity leave, I don't think it's worth my while, I'm going to shut down this factory. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? We can't force him or her legally to open the factory. We don't give them any funding. We don't give them operating expenditure. In fact, our announcements are only for small to medium enterprises. Medium enterprise, the threshold being from $300,000 to $1.25 million. They'll shut down, they'll go. So it's unfair to say that. And Mr. Speaker, sir, most people aren't going to, for example, fire people for the sake of it. Honorable Prasad on one hand says he was lamenting this morning about some bus company wanting to reduce the hourly rate from over $4 to $3.50 and saying that how the Ministry of Labour is harassing them. On the other hand, he is going to bring a motion tomorrow to say we should have a higher minimum wage. These are the challenges of our time. This is the kind of contradiction that's coming from him, Mr. Speaker, sir. Whatever it is, your end of week statement. But it's the same argument. The logic is not there. Today is lamenting about the fact that his friend, the bus operator, cannot bring down the bus hourly rate for the bus driver from $4 to $3.50, and tomorrow he's going to argue for making it $5. If the minimum wage is going to be $5, all the other people's minimum wage is $3.50, will ask for $8, $9. Mr. Speaker, sir, I would urge members of Parliament to please support this bill. This provides certainty and sustainability, and as we said, it's a temporary measure, and where we employees get a particular level of camaraderie in respect of working together, getting that certainty, so we can then progress and bring ourselves out of this pandemic. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir.
Thank you, Honourable Attorney General, for your right of reply. Whoever's telephone is ringing there, make sure you keep in good relations with your mother-in-law, because that's